Hello, my friends. Welcome to this full moon report for the full moon in Virgo. It's going to happen at 5 degrees of the sign of the devotee, it's the sign of devotion. It's the sign of the keeper of the apothecary, the keeper of the library, the one who is, the record keeper. Virgo is the nervous system of the zodiac, and it's the quality control. They're wherever we find Virgo in our own charts, or where we can encounter Virgo people, or if you are a Virgo person with your sun, your moon, your ascendant in Virgo, you're the quality control people of the zodiac. And this full moon has a definite quality control feature to it. It is in an opposition with the sun. Now, full moon is always a moment where the sun and the moon are opposite each other. The full face of the moon is revealed. Full moons are a moment of culmination. They are a moment of revealing, and then a moment of release, right? So we feel that emotional release of the energies that have been building since the new moon. So you can go back to my new moon video right before this one to get a sense of what kinds of energies were activated at that time and what's culminating on the 23rd or 24th of February. All right. So I'm really thrilled right now to announce my 5-week course called Lilith Dark Queen. And this is a 5-week experience where we will be connecting with the entity, the goddess, the archetype, and the energy current of Lilith. So we'll be utilizing art making and energy work, trance journeys, sacred writing, poetry, spells, and we'll be doing some movement too. So serpentine belly dance movement to really call her in and evoking the inner mysteries of the dark queen Lilith. Now, you don't have to be somebody who is a dancer or a poet or an artist or think of yourself as creative to participate in this class. It's open to all genders, body shapes, abilities. You can tailor it for yourself. It takes place online over 5 Tuesdays. There will be live classes. You don't have to be there for that either. Lilith is an archetype and an energy and a being that's close to my heart. I have Lilith rising in my own chart, and this is a course that's been asked for many times over, so I'm able to present this to you right now, and I'm really pleased with it. So go to my website at aprilsarcana.com. You can register for the early bird rate until March 12th. If you become a Patreon member, you get a 13% off discount on top of that. And then if you get the Lilith reading as well, so you get the bundle of the class and the Lilith reading, you get an additional $50 off USD. So I look forward to seeing you there. Now, opposing the moon, as I say, is the sun. And the sun is in a kind of a 3-way conjunction with Mercury at 2 degrees, which is the ruler of Virgo, the lord of Virgo. This is why Virgo rules the nervous system, because Mercury is said to be the planet that speaks to our nervous system, right? To the condition of our nervous system. And Virgo is the physicalizing. So the nervous system is a system that we have in our physical bodies. So we tend to think of thought, maybe as something abstract or something that's not bodily, but the brain and the nervous system are physical, right? It's interesting to remember that. And so Mercury, we're looking at the condition of Mercury to see, how this full moon is going to play out. So we'll be talking about that a little bit more. And Saturn is also part of this 3-way conjunction. So it's Mercury, the sun, and Saturn all in a row opposing the moon in Virgo. Okay, so those planets in Pisces, we're in Pisces season now. We have Mercury in Pisces, which is the mind of the poet or the dreamer, the mystic, right? Not the mind of linear logic or things that are literal. Not really what it is. It's more of an oceanic vast, you know, it's the water element. So it has to do with the source of life and creative possibility. So that's the mode of thinking that's favored with Mercury in Pisces. And Saturn here in Pisces also has been traveling through Pisces and is moving into some territory now that is new. And when I say new, it doesn't mean that Saturn's never been in Pisces before, but it's been, you know, 30 years since Saturn's been in this area. So there's some new challenges. And those challenges are, or testing, or manifestation, or limits, right? These are some of Saturn's themes. Time constraints, quality control. Saturn also has to do with quality control, right? You know, I think of the Hermit card in the tarot when I think of this full moon, right? There's this purification process with this full moon. So we're called upon to do some spring cleaning, some purification, to get back to our devotion. What are we devoted to that's bigger than ourselves, right? That can feel like, you know, okay, what about me, right? What about what I need? But actually what happens is when we're devoted to something more than ourselves, we tend to feel better about ourselves oftentimes. So when we're feeling too concerned about our status or elevating our name or what our achievements are and all of this, we can kind of lose energy. So going back to what's the core devotion that I am here to do, to be devoted to? What is it that I'm devoted to that's bigger than myself, but that also is myself? Because that's Pisces, right? Pisces is that reflection that the entire world is ourselves. We are the world's soul. There's nothing separate, right? But yet, here we have Saturn opposing this moon, who's saying there is a limit, there is a boundary, there is the end of the line. There is, you know, Saturn was considered to be the dweller on the threshold, you know, the end of the line in the solar system, the visible solar system, right? Everything beyond that has to be sensed with technology that's more than just our naked eye. So Saturn's that end of the line. So there's this conjunction that's forming and getting closer after this full moon happens, and it gets together on the 28th is when the pinnacle sort of is, but we'll be feeling it on the 27th, on the 29th, you know, and really from now, you know, from the time that you're listening to this recording until the end of the month of February, we'll be feeling this kind of contraction, right? And a call to pay attention to the details, to pay attention to the quality of things. Does this feel like something that's aligned with the direction that I want to go? Does this feel aligned with my life purpose? Is this the place where I want to put my devotional energy? So it's possible that as, you know, Mercury, the Sun, and Saturn close in on each other, and there'll be a bunch of, they're sort of doing this leapfrog kind of dance with each other through this. But as this happens, there can be, you know, a stop, a sort of a hard stop, a dead end that's necessary to move us forward into new territory that we haven't been in before. So there may be something that we're devoting ourselves to either consciously, or sometimes we devote ourselves to things sort of unconsciously. They're just things that we do. It's what we've been doing. It's what we do. And it's not aligned anymore, you know? So there may be a demand from Saturn. That's usually how we meet Saturn, is like there's some sort of squeeze, there's some sort of contraction, there's some sort of invitation we can't refuse, right? Where we have to upgrade, where we have to accept that the end has been reached. This cycle of manifestation has completed. We don't need the things we're thinking that we need. The moon is about need and attachment. You know, when we have an opposition to Saturn from the moon, you know, we can feel like something is lost, something is squeezed away, you know, wrested out of our hands. You know, the moon is our inner infant and our hunger, and Saturn is about growing up and responsibility and getting our needs met. Sounds really sexy, doesn't it? You know? But you know what's really sexy? Being aligned. You know, what's really sexy is being able to meet our needs, our emotional needs, our just needs in life in general, so that we can feel free, right? That's one of the Saturn's, you know, lessons, is that the more that we show up and we're present, we're really with what's going on, what's presenting itself, often as fate, you know, as something that is a season. You know, when we align ourselves with the seasons, oftentimes, then we get the freedom, because we're not fighting with reality. We're not arguing with reality. We're not striving to make it different. We're not grabbing on to things, trying to not make things, you know, disallow things from ending and changing. And it's hard. Sometimes we really want to fight it. But I was saying before, like, how unsexy, you know, this sounds. But sexy, you know, what's sexy is presence, right? Is someone being really present. When we are really present, there's so much power in that. Whenever we're trying to sidestep or people please, or again, arguing with reality, right? Is that hot to see somebody argue with reality? It's not. We don't feel hot when we're doing it, right? So, I mean, you know, or just not proactively answering to our purpose or our true nature, we get misaligned and we lose power that way too. So this full moon is like trying to help us get things back in order, you know? So it's ending something that needs to be released so that, you know, we can, so that we can start something new with this Aquarius energy that's going on. And also, it kind of clears the decks for the next things that are coming in. And with all this Aquarian energy, you know, we have with Venus here, with Mars here, with Pluto here, we're getting these downloads from, you know, higher self, outer space, you know, intuition, spidey senses, like wherever this comes from, right? Our shamanic journeys are, you know, we're getting these kinds of downloads available of genius, of weird ideas that might just work, you know, of new directions to go in. So we want to be collecting those ideas and, you know, allowing the alchemy that Pluto in Aquarius is offering us to happen, you know, so it's important that we honor the energy of this full moon to do the spring cleaning, to clear the decks, to purify, to honor the Saturnian influence of right timing, of time commitments, you know, needing to be made to get a result, of things ending, things beginning, I think of the hermit card association with Virgo, and I also think of the hermit, you know, informally as Saturn, right? The holding of one's own lantern, self, you know, our opinion coming from our own counsel rather than a committee, a team of people who offer their viewpoints, right? To really trust in ourselves. This full moon, I mean, when I say that, I can feel like that's kind of the crux of it. So self-trust is really what's being offered up here and what we're being invited to cultivate. And what are the ways, let's explore right now, like what are the ways that we can cultivate self-trust? Being true to our word with other people and with ourselves. When we're willing to take responsibility and take the risk for our decision-making, even though we might make a mistake, even though we might upset or offend somebody else, that we make decisions based on what we know to be true in our guts. We grow in self-trust when we honor our boundaries, which is a big thing that Saturn has to do with, right, is our boundaries. And boundaries aren't just about, you know, stopping other people from doing things to us that we don't want, or, you know, stopping violations. It's also about getting what we need. So we can have incoming boundaries, which is somebody violating our space or, you know, doing something that's just not cool that way, incoming, right? Touching us when we don't want to be touched, or, you know, and etc. And then there's outgoing boundaries too, where somebody who we thought was committed to us, or that we had a connection to, or that we have an attachment need, you know, attachment bond with, that they disappear. Ghosting is an outgoing boundary cross, you know, not answering a friend, you know, if a friend messages us or we message them about something really important to us and we just don't hear from them, that's a boundary cross, right? So boundaries are part of this. So honoring our boundaries, and we do that when we know what we're feeling. So that's why it's so crucial for us to know what we're feeling in present time. So again, we come back to this idea of presence and being able to express what we feel in the right place and the right time. So disclosing information about ourselves in the right place at the right time with the right people. So there's a lot around trust here, trusting ourselves, trusting other people, trusting the universe. And Pisces energy is about insisting on trusting the universe, and Virgo energy is about discernment. And so the two of them together is this balance, right? So in order to live in a way that produces joy and opens us up to spontaneity and aliveness, you know, for energy flow, we do have to trust that things are going exactly the way that they should, that things are happening and unfolding in right timing, that we are in the right place at the right time, that everything that's happened up until now in our lives has led us to this place, this right place and right time, that other people are showing us exactly who they are, you know, and that it's not up to us to educate or fix or, you know, strive to make it different. That, okay, this is, I trust that you're telling me exactly who you are by, you know, what you're saying, how you're acting, how we're interacting, etc. And, you know, act from there in terms of boundaries and trust and closeness in the relationship. We have Jupiter in Taurus continuing to make a sextile to Saturn. Now it's moving, it's what we call separating. So the aspect is getting weaker instead of stronger. They never really quite got into the sextile completely. A sextile, though, it's a harmonious aspect. And so even with, if there's a hard no, if that is what happens, Jupiter's promise in Taurus, the sign that grows things, the sign of the flowers blooming in spring, Beltane, Bialtina, right? The that hinge of the wheel, the greening, you know, where life force comes back in, ruled by Aphrodite, Venus. So there's an erotic, you know, erotic being not just sexual, but that's part of it. It's just that the pulsation of life on Earth, you know, of that energy. That's what Taurus has to do with, you know, the blooming, the growing, the producing. So it's Jupiter in this sign is like flourishing and making this a sextile, again, a harmonious aspect to Saturn. So there's something else that's trying to grow. And we need to clear the area for that growth to happen. And Jupiter's saying, listen to your higher self, listen to your gut, your intuition, the way that you're guided by something that isn't logic. Your logic is a great tool, right? It's not the definition of intelligence. So we have to honor, in order for us to gain true wisdom, right? We have to honor the knowing, particularly in our bodies with this full moon, because the earth element is so strong. Jupiter's making a trine aspect to the full moon. The moon will continue to go through the zodiac quickly and go right into that trine from Virgo. So there's help. There is abundance that's waiting on the other side of this dead end that you've reached. Okay, I need to back up out of here and go a different direction. This direction doesn't have what I'm looking for. You know, we may need to grieve it, mourn it, right? Have the feelings we're going to have about it, but ultimately we're going to get bored here. It's not it. Jupiter has this promise of there is something more. So you can feel okay about releasing something that's not at the level you're going to need it to be to move forward. And then you'll feel that, yes, coming after, you know, after the end of this month, there's something else happening for you, right? We do have, again, that stellium in Aquarius with Pluto and Mars and Venus. Mars and Venus are just coming out of a very fertile conjunction, right? So there's a lot of creative energy, a lot of alchemy there, a lot of Aquarius is about hope. It's about healing. I think of Aquarius association with the star card and the tarot, about the future, the recovery after, you know, duress, some kind of hardship or some impoverished situation, then there is this flourishing of energy, right? The water bearer. The water bearer isn't the water itself. It's the messenger that there's more life coming. It's here. It's, you know, this is the vision. There's a vision. There's a dream that can sustain you until we get to where this next thing manifests. Imagine it. Imagine this best case scenario. You know, imagine yourself walking as the being that has that best case scenario, is it the being that's feeling the way that you want to be feeling in the future. So when we know that something is coming down the pike that's going to be better than what we're doing now, it can soften the feeling of needing to release and contract and retract. And, you know, I mean, I think this full moon is an opportunity to like break contracts, you know, that we've made that aren't viable anymore. Especially anything where there's been a deal breaker kind of energy to it or incident. We have in this chart the North Node and Chiron, you know, exactly conjunct. That means they're together at the exact same place in the zodiac. And when that happens, that means that they're like, they're acting as one unit and they're mixing, they're blending energies, right? So the North Node is kind of like our collective high destiny. It's what we're called toward. It's where we're maybe like awkward. We're not super sure of ourselves, but it's renewing energy. It's like, it's where we're evolving toward. You know, the South Node's in Libra by contrast, which is what we've done and where we're drawing energy from. It's where we're resourced, right? But not necessarily the place that we need to go. So we're being called toward. Aries is about newness and fresh energy. Aries is kind of like the perpetual adolescent of the zodiac, you know, like no matter how many times Aries has been through something, Aries is still brand new again, you know. There's something unbeatable about Aries because it's our essential I am-ness. I am that I am, right? And we have Chiron here. We're seeing where the wounding is around that, where we feel like, you know, I am that I am, but I'm kind of afraid to be because I could get damaged somehow. I have been damaged that way. It hurt. I don't want to be hurt like that again. And we're right to not want to be hurt like that again. That's not a malfunction. You don't just, you know, go out into the world full on vulnerable and open to everyone and everything. You know, we can't do that because that's not discernment. That's not boundaries. That actually doesn't honor and protect what's most important about us, which is our self-value, you know? So we're learning about self-value with this Chiron North Node. The inherent self-value that we have, right? That's not necessarily to be earned. It's I am that I am. And what's so cool about that is that when we sit in that and we're just like, I am that I am, and you feel it and you really let what you are like expand, you can feel that energy kind of expanding from your center. The way we tend to move from that place gets the kind of successful outcomes generally that we want, that we're trying to have by not being what I actually am. You know, by masquerading as something that we think it should look like because of the we've got the wound, you know, we've got the perpetual limp, we've got the hurt that we're trying to protect. So it's really important with this full moon that we soothe our nervous systems, right? Because, you know, Chiron North Node is nothing to sneeze at. You know, it can really, especially if you have anything around that 16 degree mark of Aries, anything, you know, I mean, and anything on the sides of that, so 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, before, you know, anywhere between like 13 and 19, you'll be feeling this, especially if you have, you know, anything in Aries, particularly there, or Libra, or Capricorn, or Cancer. So any of those cardinal signs, you'll be feeling that more, you know, but especially Libra or Aries, right? So, you know, Chiron, you know, something that occurs to me, Aries represents the arteries. So all the zodiac signs have areas of the body that they have jurisdiction over. And Aries is the face, the head, the teeth, but it's also the arteries, right? And Libra rules the veins, the returning. So Aries is the sending out and Libra is the returning, right? Self and other, right? So I think about this Chiron North Node conjunction, and to tie it back around to some of the themes I talked about with the full moon overall. I mean, another overlapping theme is this theme of trust. What makes your heart beat? Do you have to think about it? You know, it's a mystery. Life makes it beat. Life is what makes it that blood go around in your body and nourish all the cells and all the bodily functions that we have. And, you know, we breathe to feed the blood. we do have control over that. And, you know, we have control, you know, around our thoughts and our feelings, and that controls our bodies, but it's all part of a system. And much of it works without us having to do anything. Just going back to the heartbeat, you know, just this primal drumbeat. I am. I think that's actually what just occurred to me is the Sylvia Plath poem. It's in the bell jar. And she says, I took a deep breath and listened to the old brag of my heart. I am. Right. And we know that Sylvia Plath had a lot of wounding, a lot of pain, a lot of chironic suffering. Right. So it's always going back to the heart, going back to trust that whatever's going on, it's there's something bigger at work. Think about all the forces, you know, an Aries theme is birth, and think about all the forces that came together to birth you. You know, all the invisible powers that happened to birth you. You weren't there to make that happen. You didn't have to supervise and facilitate, you know, you didn't have to strive. You were in the womb, Pisces, and then you showed up. Aries came out of the womb. I am. You know, there is something maybe to meditate with about that I am-ness, to soothe the wounding right now, to soothe the nervous system, to soothe the anxiety that we might be feeling, you know, with these electric Aquarian energies that are just like, you know, like kundalini and, you know, like panic attacks. I mean, all of it, right? And like, then we have, you know, Saturn being like, nope. I'm like, okay. You know, I'm trying to open to my soul here, Pisces. And here we've got Saturn, like, get a job, you know, okay. Right? And then we have this Aries thing that is ongoing, that's been present through a few lunations now, and will continue to be, where that wound around existing, you know, is being felt. The wounds that happen just from being alive, you know, just living a life, daring to live. We get wounded. We get rejected. Things kind of suck sometimes. And then they don't. We don't feel what you're feeling now, you won't feel later. You're not going to feel like this for the rest of your life. You know, no matter what we're feeling, we're not going to feel like this for the rest of our lives. And being alive is a miracle. So one of the antidotes to things becoming small, like they might feel with this full moon, is gratitude. That's where Jupiter can really help us when we have gratitude. And I know that, again, that's unsexy too. It's like, okay, gratitude and responsibility and quality control. Like, oh my God, like, why am I even listening to this astrology report? You know? But Jupiter is saying, like, you know, gratitude is what grows things. When we don't have gratitude for what we have, they tend to atrophy. Right? They're not tended like the way that we need to water a plant. You need to water the things in your life that you have with gratitude so that they remain, you know, so that they bloom and they change into even bigger and better things. This is the principle of Jupiter and Taurus. This is how you grow things. And Jupiter is assisting Saturn. So they're working as a team. This is something to remember as we're going through this. They're working as a team. The no guy and the yes guy, right? They're working together to be like, no to this, but yes to this. Look, what do you already have that's bringing you joy and happiness? Go to where the joy and happiness already exists, where the flow already exists. That's where you go next. That's going to lay the groundwork for the next thing that's upgraded to come down the pike, you know? That's the guidance that Jupiter's giving us with the trine to the full moon and the sextile to Saturn, you know, expanding what we already have by saying thank you, universe, thank you, world. And Saturn's gonna like that too. Saturn in Pisces is like devotional work. I like it. Good stuff. That's a good direction to go in because I'm the guy, Saturn says, who manifests stuff. So if you want me to work with you, then I want you to do a daily devotional practice. That's what you, Virgo has to do with also is daily, what we do daily. Virgo is the you are what you eat sign, right? And it's, you know, that means that our lives are made up of the small things. Our devotion, what we are actually devoted to, is made up of what we do moment to moment. And those moments make up a day and those days make up our life, right? So earth signs like to grow things. So there's a lot of different kind of contradictory energies going on that might feel confusing. But going back to the I am beat of your heart and trusting in life, accepting when something is ending, that there's a season for something. And what does that mean? It means another season's coming in. That's what it means. That something is trying to birth that's closer to our high destiny, that's getting us back on track. There's a course correction. And that there's more coming. And the best way to prepare for that is to have gratitude for what already is. All right. So with that, we're done. And I will talk to you at the new moon. Take care. Bye now.